respected dignitaries, eminent scientists, Padma Vibhushan Dr. Anil Kakodkar, former chairman AEC, secretary DAE, Sri K.N. Vyas, chairman AEC, secretary DAE, Dr. D.K. Sinha, director MD and chairman INS Hyderabad branch, Rear Admiral Sanjay Chaube, CMD CIL, Sri N. Sai Baba, former CE NFC, additional directors of AMD who are physically present with us in Dr. Homi Baba Auditorium, AMD Hyderabad, and few others like Dr. Dinesh Srivastava, CE NFC, former CE NFC Sri R. N. Jayaraj, regional directors and retired officers of AMD, NFC, ECILs, and so many other dignitaries who have joined us online from different parts of the country, officials of INS Mumbai, executive committee members of INS Hyderabad branch, my dear colleagues and friends, a very good afternoon. We are here to witness and be part of a momentous occasion of inauguration of a webinar series being organized part of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav 2021-22. Without further delay, it's my pleasure to invite Dr. D.K. Sinha, Director AMD, to stay to the stage for the welcome address. Sir, please.
Namaskar and a very good afternoon to all. Today, AMD in association with INS Hyderabad branch is initiating the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav webinar series 2021, Atmanirbharta in Science. As you are aware, this year our nation is celebrating the 75th year of independence. To commemorate the monumental occasion, our Honorable Prime Minister inaugurated the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav by flagging off Dandi March from Sabarmati Ashram, Ahmedabad on 12th March 2021. The celebration started 75 weeks before the 75th anniversary of our independence and will end on 15th August 2023. This is indeed a befitting celebration of India's hard-earned independence and marks a unique way of mapping the nation's eventful journey since independence. Government of India has decided that all departments and ministries will host a set of activities focusing on citizen participation for a resurgent Atmanirbhar Bharat. Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav is yet another defining moment in our national journey, a moment of celebration, a moment of relocation of the illustrious legacy handed over to us by the countless freedom fighters. We must strive to become Atmanirbhar or self-reliant in all areas. That is the greatest tribute we can pay to our freedom fighters. Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav gives us an opportunity to highlight our achievements since inception, as well as rededicate ourselves towards making India a self-reliant nation. In accordance with the guidelines of Government of India received from DAE, AMD has planned several events including a webinar series Atmanirbharta in Science in association with INS Hyderabad branch, featuring an invited talk every month by eminent personalities during the year long Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. And these talks will be documented, and we are thinking to bring these talks in a form of well documented memoir which will be probably released with the blessings from DAE in a form of memoir maybe 15th August 2022. This is the idea behind all these lectures and documenting them in a form of good book. Today we are hosting the inaugural invited talk of the webinar series by the leading figure of atomic energy in our country, Padma Vibhushan Dr. Anil Kakodkar, former chairman AC and secretary DAE. On this occasion, I welcome Sri K. N. Vyas, chairman AC and secretary DAE. Today's chief guest, Padma Vibhushan Dr. Anil Kakodkar, former chairman AC and secretary DAE, is also welcomed through virtual mode. We have guest of honor Dr. Dinesh Srivastava, CENFC, who is connected with us virtually because of some unavoidable work. He is, could not come to this auditorium, and he has sent his best wishes, and he is connected with us. And we are fortunate to have our guest of honor, Rear Admiral retired Sanjay Chauve Saab, with us in this hall. We are also fortunate to have Rajaramanna Fellow and former C NFC Sri N Sai Baba with us, who is present here in this hall. We welcome all the dignitaries in this hall and through virtual mode. In addition to this, since the time of virtuality has come and this whole proceeding is being telecasted through WebEx mode as well as by YouTube, and many head of the DA units are also joined with this program, I welcome the DA guest on this hall through virtual mode. In addition to Galaxy of Indian Nuclear Science Society office bearers and members, our retired seniors from DA family, they have also connected with us for this program. My colleague Sri B. Sarvanan, Dr. Sunil Kumar, Sri R. Mamlan, Additional Director AMD, and Regional Director from various regions of AMD, Group Heads, CEO JCFA, and Chief Security Officer AMD, they are all associated in physical mode and through virtual mode. I welcome on this occasion to all those who are available with us. We are grateful to our respected Chairman AEC and Secretary DAE Sri K. N. Vyas for his gracious presence to deliver the inaugural address of the webinar series. We are indeed privileged and honored to have among us our beloved former Chairman AEC and Secretary DAE Padma Vibhushan Dr. Anil Kakodkar as the chief guest of today's program and delivering the inaugural invited talk on Atmanirbhar in Atomic Energy to Atmanirbhar in Clean Energy in the webinar series. I am also grateful to Dr. Dinesh Srivastava for his virtual participation, and Rear Admiral Sanjay Chauve for gracing this occasion by his presence in the venue. I now invite respected Sri Vyas sir to deliver the inaugural address to the webinar series 2021. Thank you. Over to DAE Mumbai.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sina. Respected chief guest of today's function, Chief Kakodkar sir. I think there is some echo I am hearing. Can try to unmute anybody in case if they have not
unmute anybody in case if they have not unmuted.
Guests of honor, Dr. Dinesh Srivastava, Chief Executive, and my senior colleagues from NFC, Mr. Jairaj and Dr. Sai Baba, who are present in today's function, Admiral Sanjay Chaubey, CMD ECIL, heads of DA units, Dr. DK Sinha, Director AMD, and colleagues from AMD, office bearers and members of INS, ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to you all. I am delighted to be present at the inaugural event of the web series Atmanirbharta in Science, being jointly organized by AMD and INS Hyderabad branch as part of Azadika Amrit Mahotsav celebrations of AMD. Azadika Amrit Mahotsav is a year-long event to celebrate India's cultural heritage and showcase the achievements over the last 75 years since her rebirth in 1947. Most of us belonging to my generation have no experience of the trials, tribulations, struggles, and sacrifices made by our freedom fighters. Much progress has been achieved over this period since independence in the spheres of agriculture, education, infrastructure, healthcare, science and technology, space, atomic energy, and many other sectors. It is important to hold an event such as this on a national scale to acknowledge our gratitude to the early leaders and recall our past achievements in order to send a message of hope and responsibility, as well as to encourage us to make even greater efforts in the future. The uranium exploration program of the country is representative of the spirit of Atmanirbharta advocated by our founding father, Dr. Homi Jahangir Bapa, right since the inception of atomic energy program. Realizing that the exploration to identify uranium deposits constitute a foundational activity for sustained development of the nuclear power program, activities related to prospecting for uranium were initiated at an early stage with the induction of Dr. D.N. Wadia, Geological Advisor, Government of India, into the four-member Atomic Energy Commission set up in 1948 under the chairmanship of Dr. Homi Bhabha. A rare mineral survey unit was established in 1949, which was reconstituted as Raw Material Division in the Department of Atomic Energy. It was renamed as Atomic Minerals Division in 1958 and as the Atomic Minerals Directorate for Exploration and Research in 1998. Efforts have been progressively intensified over the years towards identifying several known and new types of deposits in different parts of the country. After Dr. Bhabha, the mantle of leadership has been borne by many outstanding successors over the decades. It is my pleasure, privilege, and honor to welcome one such outstanding leader and achiever, Dr. Anil Kakodkar. Dr. Anil Kakodkar is a recipient of Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan, and Padma Vibhushan by the Government of India. He is currently member Atomic Energy Commission and former chairman AEC and secretary DAE, as well as chairman Rajiv Gandhi Science and Technology Commission, Government of Maharashtra. The achievements of Dr. Kakodkar are well known, not only to this gathering and the entire DAE fraternity, but indeed to the entire country. I would not be taking time to describe all of them as it would run into several pages. However, what has been noteworthy is that apart from his immense contributions towards the mainstream activities in the nuclear fuel cycle technologies of DAE, he has been equally instrumental in pushing forward the numerous spin-off technologies of DAE towards societal and industrial applications. Advanced Knowledge and Rural Technology Implementation, in short called Akriti, program of DAE has been one such initiative. The deployment of technologies for a better quality of life to the citizens of India has received considerable attention and success under his leadership. AMD stalwarts would also particularly recall the fillip provided to uranium exploration under his mentorship, due to which we are today comfortably placed with respect to uranium reserves in the country. I would also like to take this opportunity to compliment AMD for scheduling a number of events such as national seminars, webinars, and invited talks by eminent personalities, as well as for the publication of commemorative volume on achievements of AMD as a part of the 75th year celebration of our independence. Now, without any further delay, it is my honor to invite Dr. Kakodkar to deliver his eagerly awaited talk, Atmanirbhar in Atomic Energy to Atmanirbhar in Clean Energy. I am sure that this inaugural talk will be inspirational and motivate each one of us to redouble our efforts with a renewed zeal to attain the goal of Atmanirbhar Bharat. Thank you very much and Jai Hind. Over to Hyderabad, please.
Vyas sir, so we'd like to put on record our sincere gratitude for your kind and motivating address, sir. Karpotkar to have his first invited talk. Sir, the stage is all yours, sir.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, very much.
Okay, I'm sharing my presentation. My presentation is there.
Yes, it has appeared.
Okay, so thank you, Dr. Sinha, for this invitation to be a part of the first webinar in the webinar series that AMD and Indian Nuclear Society Hyderabad chapter has organized as a part of Atmanirbhar Bharat webinar series. I think let me at the outset first pay my respects to all our freedom fighters, because of whom we are here, and we are now entering the 75th year of our independence. So my greetings to all of you, beginning with us, Chairman AC, all heads of the units, particularly located in Hyderabad, the Director AMD, Chief Executive NFC, and CMD ECIL. Heads, there are several people in this webinar audience, so from Hyderabad, and indeed many other places in the country. So my greetings to all of them. Normally, a webinar of this kind or a lecture of this kind would naturally recount past. I have decided to do the other way, in the sense I think past is something that all of you know. But I would like to kind of look at future, particularly in the context of India and in the context of India's energy scene and what atomic energy can do. So that's broadly what I'm going to do. And I hope you would find this presentation useful, but also appropriate to the occasion, because, you know, we are talking about Atmanirbharta in science and technology, and that's actually crucial for a country to be counted as a leader in the world. You know, unless you have technological capabilities, and not technological capabilities in terms of following others, that also is important, but technological capability in terms of leading others is even more important. And that is what earns the strong place for the country in the world at large. And so I think as far as energy, which has become central issue of debate worldwide, I thought we should look at the energy scene in that context. So if I can go to the next slide. Is it changing? Yes. The slide has changed, no? Yeah, okay.
Slide.
Shall I make it full screen? Maybe I can.
Yes.
Full screen I'll make, yeah. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So let us begin. And to begin, I have picked up a Sankey diagram, which represents the overall energy balance from the report Energy Statistics India 2021, fairly recent report issued by Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. And that Sankey diagram, as contained in that report, it looks like what you are seeing in the center of this figure. It's a very complex diagram. So I have extracted some numbers and put them on the left-hand side of the figure, as well as the supply side is on the left-hand side and the demand side, the load side, is on the right-hand side, at least the first two columns. And the remaining two columns is essentially guessing into the future. One, a future by the year 2050, hopefully when we would have reached enough energy supply in per capita consumption terms to guarantee the best possible quality of life. And second column is a future where we have achieved a kind of zero emission targets. The whole world is looking at eliminating emission. So now there is going to be a debate and pressure that both of them should be realized by 2050. I have decided to put them in two separate columns because I think the timescales for the two are likely to be different. And I would like to dwell on this figure for a little while to appreciate an overall energy picture for the country. Now, let us begin with the commercial primary energy supply. And the main elements of that primary energy consumed in the year 1920 are in that block on the left-hand side of the figure, which you know the major part is coal, 62% of the overall thing. And the next bigger part is the crude, 27% of the overall energy supply. Next comes natural gas, 5.8 or 6% of the overall energy supply. And then you have three clean energy sources. Nuclear, 1.2%. This is at the primary energy level. Hydro, 1.3%. And renewable energy, 1.2%. We must remember that while coal, crude, and natural gas are the main components of primary energy supply, but good part of that is imported, particularly crude. 22.6% of the total primary energy supply is imported. Similarly, 15.6% of the total primary energy supply is imported in the form of coal, and similarly 3% is imported in the form of gas. Now, and that's a matter to worry, because as we move forward, our demands will grow. And if we do in business as usual manner, then in fact, our import bill will keep on increasing. If we say our energy supply has to go 4 to 5 times, I think our import bill will also go 4 to 5 times or even larger. And I think that cannot go on. It will give a big kind of drag create a drag on the economy of the country. Now, today, of course, to reach the zero emission target, the net zero, we have to get clean energy. And clean energy, I have put them in different color, purple. Nuclear, hydro, and renewable, they are just 3.7% of the total energy supply. Now, so we have the task of enhancing our clean energy supply from 3.7% to 100%, and then take it further by another factor of 4 or 5, because India's energy requirements are growing, and we will reach equilibrium only something like 2,400 kilogram oil equivalent energy consumption per capita. And so that's a huge challenge, but that's the present situation as far as the supply side is concerned. Now let us look at it, what's happening on the demand side. On the demand side, of course, on that Sankey diagram, there are large number of segments written, small things. I have clubbed them into three groups: industrial, residential, and agriculture, and transport. These are the three groups I have put. And then the energy demand I have put in two categories. One, energy demand in the form of electricity, and the energy demand in the form of either heat or the process needs. And you would notice that as far as the industry demand is concerned, today around 4.7% of the total primary energy supply. Well, these numbers are all based on same base total. So 4.7% of the total primary energy supply is the electricity that goes to industry. If I continue with electricity, 6.1% of the total energy supply goes to either residential or agricultural use. And of course, at this moment, not much goes to transport. It has begun. But going forward, you do expect electricity to be a major supply component for transport. Let us look at the process and the heat energy needs. And almost as large as 27% of the total primary energy supply, it goes to industry. You know, you use coal for heating, you use coal for different processes, for example, in steel making. And same thing is true with oil and gas. So 27% goes to industrial use. Around 11.5% of energy in the form of heat energy, it goes to residential and agriculture, but primarily it is the cooking energy that we use for in our kitchens. And then 5.8% energy, it primarily goes at heat because it's consumed in the internal combustion engines or other similar engines. And then there it is converted to motive power. So it goes in transportation, 5.8%. So that's broadly the mix. Now all this, so obviously you will see that the total energy that we have, some part of it, something like 10.8% goes as electricity. And to produce that electricity, you will have to also reject certain amount of heat as a requirement of Carnot or Rankine or whatever thermodynamic cycle one is talking about. So you actually reject 37.5% of the primary energy supply. You reject this into atmosphere or heat sink. As far as the thermal or process energy is concerned, you have 27 plus 11, so 38 plus 5, so 43. So around 43, 44, 46%. That kind of energy goes to as heat or process. And a small part, around 9% of total energy, it is either it's lost in conversion Or a good part of that is, you know, you make other products, petrochemicals, for example. And so that is the overall energy balance in our country. Going forward, if you look at that column, 2050, to reach Human Development Index of 0.95, which is about the best to support the best quality of life one can imagine, then obviously our electricity consumption will have to, the overall energy consumption will go up everywhere. But I think the proportion of electricity would certainly go up. On the industry side, in addition to hydrocarbon, coal and all, I think hydrogen will start playing an additional role. So it will be everything else plus hydrogen. On the residential and agricultural side, again, you expect the energy use to go up, but also electricity use to go up. But I think in terms of the, you know, the role gas will play will become very high. Today, good part of cooking, particularly in our villages, is out of what is known as non-commercial energy. And that non-commercial energy is not reflected in the table on the left-hand side. And that is, but I must put it to you, see that fraction is something like around 20% or more of the total energy supply. And that's also contributes to the poor air quality, the health issues, particularly among women and children. And so I think it's important that all that changes and we replace that energy in the form of clean cooking energy, which to my mind is gas. Of course, electricity can also be used, but gas can play a much larger role. Now, today, as a part of Ujjwala scheme, government is emphasizing LPG, which might continue because in urban areas, particularly, there is a mix of PNG, which is beginning and it will grow, but also there is LPG. But in rural areas, I think we should have more and more biomass conversion into gas. Now, it could be in a variety of ways, and I don't want to go into the details there. But in addition to PNG and LPG, I think we should give a lot of emphasis to CBG, compressed biogas, and convert the biomass, both the surplus agriculture residue, but more importantly, the non-commercial energy which goes to kitchen. Because I think they all contribute to something like, in my guess, around 40%, 45% of the total energy, which, you know, we are all driven by the Western vendors, and we are not paid much attention to converting that into clean energy. But at least talking about residential and agriculture area, I think CBG should, and government is giving, there is a scheme called Satat, but that is the intention of using CBG for transport sector. I think that should progressively enhance to supply to kitchen, rural kitchens, and in fact, replace the LPG that goes in the form of Ujjwala scheme. Coming to transport sector, of course, one does expect electric transport to start playing bigger and bigger role. I have not, the bottom last row, I have put a question mark. But I think hydrogen will start making role because according to me, electric transport means, of course, electric transport, which is where you carry electricity and batteries. But more importantly, for longer endurance, longer range, and particularly for heavy vehicles, I am 100% certain that it would be hydrogen carried on board or another fuel carried on board, which can be reformed to hydrogen, and then use fuel cells to convert that to electricity and then use electric traction for driving. And I'm aware of certain experiments and on a kind of a demo scale. And I'm pretty certain that this pretty soon will become cheaper than diesel engines. and will become popular. And that is the transition which I think it certainly would take place. So that's broadly the overall picture, the transition to developed and decarbonized in India. So let us look at atomic energy in that overall broader context. So I'll go to the next slide. You have the next slide, I suppose. Yeah. So what are the mega trends that one sees? It is just a recap, but just it's good to remember that. As I said, the clean energy supply has to increase. And I gave you two factors. So it has to increase 120 to 140 times. And that's the challenge for clean energy supply, including atomic energy. As we expect, this increase has to come primarily through solar, wind, and nuclear. Share of electricity in the must go up primarily for e-mobility, but also for hydrogen production. Because, you know, good part of that hydrogen production, because we're talking about green hydrogen, and that has to come from clean electricity. There may be other ways, but that's going to be the primary mode. So obviously, electricity generation will have to go up very much. And for atomic energy, I think it's a blessing in disguise, because when the share of atomic energy in the grid goes up, there will be pressure on us for flexing or running, instead of running the power plant as base load, running them in load follow mode. Now, if you want to do that, and of course, one is you design fuel and carry that out, and that I think we should do. But in addition, a parallel track could be you do cogeneration of hydrogen and do flexing by adjusting how much hydrogen or how much electricity you produce. And I think electrolyzers, particularly small size electrolyzers, are available. And I would strongly recommend Nuclear Power Corporation to actually put this hydrogen production small scale in a safe manner, but experiment to produce hydrogen, because hydrogen is a consumptive use, for generator cooling, you require hydrogen. So small scale, you should do that and try it out so that you get experience to do things on a bigger scale going forward. And by that time, the hydrogen cost production itself will come down. So that's one thing we should start beginning right now. Another important megatrend is non-commercial energy, which I mentioned, could be as large as 20% or more, to be converted to clean cooking energy and used locally. That's the important point. And this will avoid the elimination of a fair bit of import bill. It also, the overall economy will become much more competitive. And the surplus biomass to be converted to hydrogen and hydrocarbon substitutes. And I think we have not recognized how much biomass is there. And that's why government is giving emphasis on the 2G ethanol. But rather than 2G ethanol, I think giving emphasis on gas, giving emphasis on hydrogen right now is an important thing to do, because 2G ethanol is not turning out to be competitive. I'm involved in some of these things. And, you create a policy, and now, unless you continue subsidy in perpetuity, this will not be sustainable. So anyway, Ministry of Petroleum is looking at this issue, and they might come up with a revised policy. But I think our policy prescription must be based on sound fundamentals. Hydrogen use in industry and also in transportation is bound to increase. And even if you do all that, I think you cannot reach zero emission without taking recourse to carbon capture and utilization. And that is because, there are many industrial activities, industrial production, where you require both coal as well as hydrocarbon as a process input. And obviously, some part of it will get converted to carbon dioxide or other greenhouse gases. And if you want to really reach net zero, then you must capture that carbon dioxide and convert it to some useful usage without allowing that to go to atmosphere. And so I consider carbon capture and utilization extremely important. And I'm very happy that there is a national network created, essentially led by our TIFR, where several groups involved in energy production field, several labs in the country, several public sector units dealing with energy, and many others, are including industry, are networking and trying to approach this problem at the very basic fundamentals, which I think is an extremely good initiative. Now, let me move on. Have you got the next slide? Yeah. So now let us come to clean energy, renewable energy. There is a notion in the country, and I think it is an ill-founded notion, but the notion in the country that we can meet our zero emission targets by just taking recourse to renewable energy. And so in that context, I want to present this picture, which is there on the top right-hand side of this figure. This is actually a figure from the OECD report, which actually talks about, it's a three-axis figure. On the vertical axis is the price of electricity, the consumer's price, consumer, whatever price they have to pay for electricity. And on the two horizontal axes, one is carbon emission constraint. So, and the other axis is the proportion between nuclear and variable energy, renewable energy, so-called decarbonization scenario. So as you approach the origin of this figure, the origin of this figure you approach zero carbon emission, and you also approach all renewable energy, zero nuclear energy. Now, if you see, there is a big peak on this cost figure, tariff figure. It suddenly shoots up as you move in that corner. You don't see that when you are away, when the carbon emissions are higher. Today, for example, you have a lot of coal and all. So when the carbon emissions are higher or there is sufficient nuclear renewable energy, you don't see that. But as you go towards the origin of this figure, it suddenly peaks up. What does it mean? It means that in absence of nuclear, even if you go to clean energy targets, the tariff could become quite high. In fact, this study, which is based on MIT study, it shows that the minimum average generation cost at zero emission or low emission, now without nuclear in the New England region of USA, and this figure is actually for that that region, the tariff will become twice. And the report has, the MIT report has similar study for TBT region of China, and there it will become in fact four times. So what it will happen for India is anybody's guess. We don't have such a study available, but I would imagine that it will be closer to China, maybe a bit higher. And the optimum cost scenario, if you look at what is the capacity, nuclear capacity as a percentage of peak demand, you will find in New England region, it has to be 60% of total energy. And in China, it has to be 80% of total energy. Again, as I said, for India also, it will be something similar. So you can imagine, you know, on one side, this may drive that, you know, solar, wind will do everything. At least I think it is far, far from reality. But unless, you know, we have not seen this study in Indian context, so it is all like different blind men looking at the picture and carrying our own imagination. Sorry for that comparison, but that is, I must be blunt, and that is what it's. So atomic energy, I think we must hammer this down. We must make country aware of this reality. And now So what is the takeaway from this figure? Large-scale nuclear power in India, and that by large-scale I mean a few hundred gigawatt electric capacity, is essential for low-tariff electricity to consumers in net zero emission scenario. Now, the MIT studies, and this chart is based on that, it shows that pairing variable renewable energy sources with steady carbon-free source such as nuclear is less costly and lower risk route. The lower cost of electricity to the end user, of course, it's important for user because they have to pay, but it is also important to make our economy competitive because, you know, energy is the input to industrial production. And industrial production, if it is based on costlier electricity, then the cost of that production will become high and we will not be able to compete in international market. So I think you want to maintain our economy competitive, nuclear must play an important role and the country must realize in atomic energy, we should carry this message all over the country. Now, the key question is, of course, rapid augmentation of nuclear power capacity. Our past record, track record is, it doesn't give us great enthusiasm or confidence. You know, within next 30 years, let us say, to reach a few hundred gigawatt capacity is a challenge where we need to do things differently than the way we have been doing. Let me go to the next slide. Now, another aspect that we must recognize is the fact that decarbonization costs money. It's not, you know, it costs money to the exchequer. It costs money to taxpayer. And here are some numbers. For example, in United States, the total electricity production is around 4,000 billion units. Decarbonizing the US power grid rapidly has been estimated by Wood Mackenzie to cost around $4.5 trillion. Germany, the annual electricity production is something like 650 billion units. And that country is already running a program to decarbonize. And that the outlay for that program is 580 billion to overhaul the energy system. Now compare that with the Indian situation. Today, India's electricity production is around 1,600 billion units. And as I said, it has to necessarily grow 4 to 5 times larger. So if India's electricity system is 8,000 billion units, it is twice of United States. And of course, about 8 times that of Germany. So you can imagine what it's going to cost us to carry out that decarbonization. And so I think we can't ignore this and we must do this in the responsible fashion and make sure that the ultimate tariff as paid by the consumer. You know, everybody compares the generation cost and says that solar energy is cheaper. It is cheaper, but then what about if you want to make sure that the grid is able to supply at will, because that is what grid is supposed to do. You must be able to supply energy even when the sun is not shining or wind is not blowing. And if it is only sun and solar and wind, then you must accumulate that energy during daytime and store. So there is an extra capital cost in energy systems and extra capital cost in storage system. And that is how, and of course you have to match the grid dynamics. So that is how the costs go up and we should be aware ourselves first, get convinced and convince others. So in that context, let me talk about our atomic energy program. I think we have a wonderful 700 megawatt PHWR. It's a made in India product, which is globally competitive. And it's a workhorse readily available for us to sort of scale up the program. And of course, Government of India has done extremely well in terms of approving a fleet mode implementation of 10 700 megawatt units. Now we must recognize that Indian PHWR is a globally competitive technology. It has the lowest capital cost among any nuclear system in the world at around 15, 20 or thereabouts crore per megawatt, which is absolutely unmatched by any foreign vendor. The second important point to note is the capital cost also compares very favorably with variable renewable energy. For example, if you compare with solar, and let's not compare with just the per megawatt cost, because solar per megawatt is per megawatt peak, nuclear per megawatt is per megawatt more or less base load power, and the two are not the same. So if you say that let us look at capital cost in crores per million units produced in a year, then you will find that for PHWR you require something like 1.9 crores and for solar you require 2.3 crores. So nuclear in fact is cheaper. Of course, nuclear, there is a larger gestation period and we suffer higher interest rate. So that is a separate problem. And that is where policy and quick implementation comes in. And that is what I was referring to earlier. The important point to note is near 100% value addition within the country has been already established for a long time. We are talking about Atmanirbhar Bharat today, but Dr. Bhabha talked about self-reliant right in his times. Long and comprehensive experience of something like 540 years of reactor years of operation of nuclear plants. And NPCIL has been doing this extremely well, consistently AAA rated company for decades. So I think the approach should be very clear. In addition to the good beginning that has been made for construction of 700 megawatt, 10 700 megawatt units in fleet mode, I think we should take up three more fleets to be taken up and completed by the year 2050. And I think there is time to do that. And this is the way it was done in France, for example. And so it's only repeating that experience. And because, you know, the urgency is to enhance the capacity, nuclear capacity. And although we may not agree to the international pressure of 2050 for zero emission, but, you know, we are living in this world and after all, it's in also our interest. Now, how do we do that? I said, we can't be doing it in a business as usual manner, because then we cannot reach that level. So you need conducive policy environment. Solar and renewable, they have renewable purchase obligations. Why can't we think of nuclear power purchase obligation? I think government should announce a policy. Low cost finance should be available for nuclear so that you have, you know, low interest and available with long payment terms, so that we'll be able to perform the same way as renewable energy. We should be eligible for tax concessions, which we were at some point of time. We should get them back and recycle all profits for further investments. Today, a good part of that government takes away by way of dividend. And I think there should be a policy change. And of course, today it is not an issue, but just like thermal plants are suffering, if there is a must-run status for renewable energy and tomorrow there is not so much of coal to back down, the nuclear will have to be backed down. And so we must get nuclear must-run status for nuclear. And the backing down should be dependent on what is in the largest or best economic interest of the country. Because, you know, everything, there is investment made, everything, there is tariff. And that should be calculated, you know, it cannot be arbitrarily done. In addition to these policy prescriptions, I think we need to take some actions on ourselves to be able to implement program faster. For example, we must improve and empower management structure. We must have synergy with the public sector units, particularly the oil PSUs, because, you know, we had MOUs with them. Nothing has happened on that. And that, I think, should change. There must be, we must work in sync with public sector units and leverage capital support. We must also work with industry and see if they can participate by way of some capital support apart from their participation in manufacture. We should, the NPCIL board should be made more empowered. And also within the board, there should be more decentralized decision making, including those which involve finance. Today, you know, audit and finance seem to be a dampener everywhere. Now, I think the principles of audit and finance are good, but we must, and it has been done in country, it has been done in atomic energy also in past. And I think we must find out new ways of implementing the program faster. Now, while that is one, we should, the major capacity should come out of 700 megawatt PHWRs. But I think we should also open up an additional stream for nuclear capacity addition to supplement the program based on 700 megawatt PHWRs. And that is because, there might be limitations, for example, availability of sites for setting up large nuclear power plants could become a challenge and could limit the total capacity deployment. So we must have a parallel stream, however small it may be. So while we have this challenge, can we think in terms of, retiring coal plants, the sites vacated by retiring coal plants, can those sites be used for setting up additional nuclear power plants? This, of course, would require a very different strategy for locating nuclear power plants. They have to be located closer to population, closer to load center. The siting, the design should be such that there will be no impact in public domain. And so siting criteria also should change in terms of proximity with population, in terms of exclusion radius, and so on and so forth. So new design where there is no offsite impact in an accident, and so no exclusion radius and no need for evacuation. There is no limitation as a result of ODC, because you never know how, but they all have a railway line because coal has to reach coal plants. And so if you can make this role transportable, construction done in a manner which can be transported on rail, and then you erect it at site. So there should be no limitation as a result of over-dimension consignment. And that is where you need modular units. We can decide what is the best modular unit that we can mass manufacture for that matter, and build capacity that site can accommodate by putting additional units that are required. And the thing should be done, rather than benefiting from economy of scale in terms of power capacity, I think we should benefit in terms of economy of volume of production by way of serial production. And so the site construction work will become minimum, and so the gestation period can, in theory, come down. So I think we need to quickly develop a factory assembled safe SMR that can be transported to sites vacated by retiring coal plants. And technology may be co-developed, not just by ourselves, although we can do that. We have the submarine PWR experience. We have HWR development experience. We also worked on the IPWR for quite some time. So I think there is enough experience, but I think it should be important that we create a consortium of industry, NTPC, NPCIL, BARC, and so on. And the technology is co-developed with that consortium. And then this consortium should actually participate in competitive bidding done by the government and set up power plants. And I am sure, because you know, there is a big movement towards small medium reactors, and they are all very expensive. They cannot match, first of all, they cannot match even our PHWR or even 700 megawatt PHWR cost per megawatt. So there is no question of their matching the small PWR cost made in the country. And so I think we'll win this hands down, and that is the way we can create a major transition. This will become a small addition because the unit size being small, the rate of addition will be only that much, but I think it will open up a new additionality. But more importantly, it will create a new modality of implementation, which we can transfer to other reactor systems. So that is the strategy that we should do, and we should think very seriously on this aspect. Now you will be wondering, what is this fellow saying? Does that mean that we forget three-stage nuclear power program? Far from it. We don't forget three-stage power program. We don't forget also our fusion program, because they are all required for long-term energy security. You know, we are talking about 2050 challenge because of climate change issue, but India and the humanity will survive for a long time. And so we need to secure our energy security for several centuries, if not longer. And so in that context, three-stage program is important. I have listed here both, of course, first stage I already talked about, but second stage and third stage elements. And there are several technology elements in terms of reactors as well as fuel cycle. And what is it that, so it's a busy slide, I don't want to get into that. But recognize that because, you know, we have done well in mastering technology and getting self-reliance in that technology for a first stage. So we are able to talk all this. I think we should realize similar status of self-reliance on all second and third stage technologies. But at this present moment, present status, I think by 2050, we may not be able to add more than 10 gigawatts. And 10 gigawatts is too small compared to the challenge that we have before the country. But I think that effort should continue, and that thrust should actually remain. I must emphasize that. Okay, so we need to learn strategies for rapid deployment. So what more needs to be done? In the context of pressurized heavy water reactors, which I already mentioned, indigenous systems, very competitive, high performance reactors. But we must also, as I said earlier, develop load following capability, so that I think with another 10 to 15 years, we should be able to run at least some of our reactors in load follow mode. Also, as I said, we should think of cogeneration of hydrogen, the last bullet on this figure. And that I think we should begin small, but progressively enhance that experience. But in addition to that, see, today our PHWRs are based on natural uranium. That leads to much larger spent fuel inventory, and that leads to much larger recycling workload, which is a major cost element. I think we should change our PHWRs to low enriched uranium. That will allow us to shrink spent fuel inventory considerably, maybe factor of 2 or even 3, and then the recycling costs will come down. So I think as the PHWR capacity exceeds, we should quickly do this. And I have recent times, I also become a champion of using thorium and high assay low enriched uranium in PHWRs, and use that as an export model. This thought came out of AHWR, but we can't talk about AHWR export today because we are not, don't have a reactor in the country. Of course, we should do that at some stage and bring that also as an export model. But till that time, we should think of PHWR export. Talking about light water reactors, of course, what we said would be a very competitive system built out of or based on the submarine experience that we have and the HWR development, as I said. We must build factory assembled small modular reactor, which can be located at existing sites vacated by retiring coal plants, as I said, inherently safe. Mass production once prototype is proven, and this is, I think, an entirely feasible option. Now, let's go to the larger domain of energy. What are the additional further strategies for decarbonization? So in terms of thrust areas, I talked about nuclear. Renewable energy and has to grow. I don't think hydro will grow very much because there is some potential, but again, siting is an issue. But to the extent it grows, I think we should explore that possibility. But the other thrust areas which are extremely important in decarbonization scenario is electric mobility, both battery-based as well as hydrogen-based. We must also emphasize conversion of surplus agri residue to hydrogen as well as hydrocarbons. Today, we are emphasizing on ethanol, 2G ethanol. But I think there are cheaper options of converting biomass to biofuels. And of course, hydrogen is a long-term objective. We should also look at, in addition to biomass, look at the policy possibility of the solar, wind, nuclear, electricity. Suresha, pani dega? To be converted to hydrogen, the green hydrogen by electrolysis, or wherever we produce high temperature by thermochemical splitting of water. We should also think in terms of, because a lot of energy is required for heating and refrigeration. And instead of using electricity for heating and refrigeration, one could use non-fossil energy, solar, for example, for purpose of heating and refrigeration. And that, at least up to some temperature range, it is eminently possible. We should also explore possibility of converting coal to fleet fuel. But as I said, going forward, we may not be able to avoid complete elimination of coal and hydrocarbon, and also develop technologies for carbon capture and utilization to minimize emission, since the minimum dependence on coal and hydrocarbon is unavoidable. And finally, I think we should remain aware that petrochemical is an important need of the society. And today, of course, we do create petrochemicals. We also import a lot. But I think we must keep augmenting our refinery capacity and design them again in a flexible mode. So if there is a need, we can produce fuel. But otherwise, we produce petrochemicals to meet our national needs, but also realize export out of that capacity. And our ability in the country in terms of refinery industry is extremely, extremely strong. I have personal experience at close quarters on this issue. Now, in terms of critical technology for all that, I think we need to develop technologies for steam electrolysis. We used to talk about it in BARC for decades now, and I hope we are able to set up large capacities, high temperature. When you're talking about, I'm talking about steam electrolysis, high temperature electrolyzer. And similarly, there is work going on in BARC on iodine sulfur. There is work going on in Institute of Chemical Technology on copper chloride. There's some work going on in IIT Delhi and ONGC and other places. But I think this technology is likely to be a bit cheaper compared to steam electrolysis. And so we should develop that. But it's a complex technology with a lot of material challenges. Solar thermal receiver. We have given emphasis to photovoltaics. But I think solar energy can make much cheaper and much bigger contribution by way of solar thermal But the challenge is it has to be done in a self-reliance way. When we talk about solar thermal or photovoltaic, we think about importing it from outside. And then, of course, it is very expensive. The way imported PWRs are very expensive. But then if you design solar thermal plants within the country, we get them manufactured, and there is a lot of customized activity here, but I think within our capability. And if you do that, then I think solar thermal will provide a much cheaper way of clean energy solution. And of course, apart from solar thermal, which will be the cheapest storage in my view, other storage technologies of battery, flow batteries and so on, that there has to be a thrust, technology thrust. And we must think in terms of production of hydrocarbon substitutes using hydrogen and biomass. I talked about petrochemical others, but there are many other substitutes, including energy materials. So that I already talked about CCUS. I normally talk about only CCU, but as it will come later in a minute, I think the amount of carbon dioxide that we have to cope up is simply too large. And so if necessary, we may have to resort to CCUS. And then, of course, we need to, in fact, fully take care of the life cycle management of energy systems, particularly solar energy, because, you know, all those solar panels going to waste, we must have a national scheme of doing so. Now, let me, last two slides, let me use the carbon capture part. Now, today, globally, we are emitting something like 31.5 gigatons of CO2 per annum. Now, as against that, not that carbon dioxide is not used. Carbon dioxide is currently used for a variety of things, like it is used in greenhouses, for example. It's used as a solvent in many places, you know, the supercritical technology, carbon dioxide is an important solvent. It's also used as a heat transfer fluid and a few other areas of food and beverages, medical uses, so on and so forth. But all that put together, the current global use of CO2 is just around 230 million tons, as against 31.5 gigatons that we are producing. So that's where I said that surplus CO2 quantum is simply too large. And we have to explore other more and more applications of doing so. We have done worldwide, there is some use already, some carbon capture work is going on. And something like 40 million tons is being captured currently annually in different plants around the world, some 21 operational, but there are also plants under construction and advanced development and in planning. The key utilization for CO2 turns out to be one, fertilizer in making of urea, and two, for enhanced oil recovery. And going forward, I think the major shift has to be in terms of conversion of carbon dioxide, either to fuels or to chemicals or to building materials. And there are actually, this slide I have based on information in the International Energy Agency report. There is a lot of information there and also in other sources on the internet. But this is an area where I think we have miles to go, and it's an evolving area, so India should catch up. I think it is more important for India compared to any other country because of the particular situation which I mentioned. And I'm happy to report that things have happened in India, not that India nothing has happened. For example, in terms of gas fermentation, you know, just like you can absorb CO2 through biological route, liquid phase fermentation, you know, ethanol and all, you can also do gas fermentation. And there is a company called LanzaTech, not an Indian company, but that company along with Indian Oil Corporation They are setting up a demo facility for gas fermentation to produce 40 million liters per annum of ethanol. And that's a work in progress, I think, at Panipat refinery. Similarly, there is a joint research that has gone on between Indian Oil Corporation, Department of Biotechnology, and LanzaTech. And they have developed a model, a novel integrated carbon capture utilization process that converts carbon dioxide into commercial grade omega-3 fatty acid esters and biodiesel. And a consortium says that they are now ready to take this process to commercial scale of deployment. And let's hope that that happens sooner than later. Yet another thing where Indian companies involved, of course, there are Chinese, other Chinese companies also, but I think the partners are same, LanzaTech, India Glycol is the Indian company, and Unilever, but this time Unilever in their plant in China. But together they have announced launch of world's first laundry capsule, you know, make of detergent in the market, made from industrial carbon emissions. So you capture CO2 and make lot of detergents. And this product has been already launched and announced in the market. And very soon Chinese market might see that brand. Now in the area of chemical absorption, I think at Tuticorin thermal plant, they have set up a 66,000 tons carbon dioxide capture of carbon dioxide per annum, and convert that into baking soda. It's, you know, I'm not very clear about the status of that plant, but there was a talk about it, and hopefully something is happening there. But even more importantly, Indian Oil has launched a design and feasibility study to capture carbon dioxide at its Koyali refinery for enhanced oil recovery. That is, they want to capture carbon dioxide from there and pump it in an oil well, ONGC oil well nearby at Gandhar. So I think these activities are welcome activities, but I think these are based on known technologies or technologies where industrial scale R&D could be done. I think this subject requires fundamental R&D, and that is the kind of network which I mentioned should come forward and get those solutions. So the CCU challenge for India is we must recognize that CO2 emissions is 2 to 3 orders of magnitude higher than current carbon dioxide use. Now in the business as usual mode, this is unlikely to happen, even though there is significant scope for increase, as I said, sixfold increase possible in utilization even at the present level. But that is not enough considering the total CO2 that is available, and so we must kind of develop circular economy where around carbon and hydrocarbons if we do that, to put carbon hydrocarbons in a circular economy, just like, you know, nature does this, and that's the challenge before our chemistry and chemical engineers, and it's a challenge which many will say go against thermodynamics, but economics is quite different things, and so I think we should, I think there are several processes which are available, which are close to the economic breakthrough, and we should look at this possibility. We need new problem definitions. We can't be defining problem with the old thinking. We need out-of-box thinking. Disruptive technologies have to come on the scene based on fundamental research, as I said earlier. The field is wide open. The challenges, can India be on the forefront? And this is what we need to achieve. And I think atomic energy should play a role, because I think we should look in terms of the larger clean energy transition. And in fact, position atomic energy along with other clean energies as clean energy transition and develop national policies on that basis. So I come to the last slide, the ecosystem for technology leadership. In fact, this is one of the thing which is very crucial. If you want to get technology leadership, Atmanirbhar Bharat, we must have the right ecosystem. Fortunately, atomic energy, we have that kind of ecosystem, and that's where we have come this far. But as you would have figured out from my presentation, we have miles to go. And that requires, you know, we can't put ourselves in silos saying, I'm doing basic research, I'm doing applied research, I'm doing industrial research, none of that kind. So we should, as a nation, develop sufficient insights for a vendor-independent autonomous decision-making. Because otherwise, somebody comes, tells us, we tend to repeat that. If industry tells something, we do our own industrial research and say, yeah, that is promising. I'm not saying that we should not do that, but we can't be limited to that. We must think of de novo approaches. And of course, I know within the current program itself, there are many things in works of that kind. But in the context of clean energy transition, there will be many more. Ability to connect, as I said, basic research, applications, proof of concept, technology, commercial deployment. So that we need to connect diverse groups with complementary capabilities working together. And that is what is the change, cultural change that we need to look at. That's the kind of ecosystem that I'm talking about. And who else other than atomic energy can transform the already good ecosystem into this next level? And finally, there should be synergy across layers. You know, it's neither top down nor bottom up. The best strategy is a combination of top down, bottom up. We must have an India energy vision and an integrated plan on the sustainability, economy, and markets. We must look at them all together. We can't look at just sustainability as scientists, because then economy won't permit that to go forward. Markets won't allow. So I think while we do research, we must understand the language of economics, language of markets, and so much so the economists and market people understand language of science. And that is the integrated system we should have. We should have a good foresight for shaping policy and its implementation. And the linking from concept to details, as I said, we must have synergistic top-down, bottom-up approach. From top to define the broad framework, broad objectives, the bottom to fill the details, consistent with that framework, consistent with that objective, but make the most competitive solution. So that is what I think we should do. We should all work together and do that. And so can I say that by 2050, in fact, 2050 is 30 years from now, India will reach centenary by 25 years from now. So shall I say that while we are talking about Atmanirbhar Bharat, as we are entering the 75th year, can we say that India will be the world leader in energy, and of course certainly create all these new paradigms and save the planet? Of course, you want to save India, you have to save the planet, and so you have to enhance the quality of life of Indians to be comparable with the best in the world, and for our survival, save the planet. So that's the leadership that we need. And so it's for all of you, the members of Indian Nuclear Society, the members of DAE family, not just Hyderabad based, but DAE units all over. And I wish all of you all the best in success in this endeavor. Thank you very much.
read a visionary lecture. We know that you are a warrior of decarbonization and a promoter of clean energy. Your lecture has put hopes and positive energy into all of us. In addition, the lecture has given a lot of pointers for all of us to think for your vision to 2050. I'm sure your blessings and well wishes are all always with us. So let us give once again a round of thunderous applause to Dr. Sunil Sapochkar. Sir, AMD and INS Hyderabad chapter is indeed grateful to you for readily accepting our invitation to deliver the inaugural lecture. As a token of our love, we wish to present you a small memento, though virtually. Sir, we'd like to request you to accept it, please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At this occasion, we'd like to thank our Chairman AEC, Sri Kane Vyas. He's our pillar of strength and motivation. With your guidance, AMD is progressing steadily and will scale new heights. We were very fortunate to get your valuable time for this function. As a token of our respect, here we present a small memento virtually to you, sir. At this moment, I would like to Dr. Srivastava, Dr. Dinesh Srivastava is also there online. Rear Admiral Sanjay Chaubey sir is also here with us. So I'd like to request Sanjay sir to come over to the stage and give his address.
Dr. Kakodkar, Sri Vyas sir, all dignitaries who have had the wonderful opportunity to listen to this lecture. I don't think I have, I should be saying anything after this wonderful lecture. But energy security for any nation, independence is one thing. Independence for energy security is also equally important. What we have heard today in this 45 minutes, I think it should ignite all minds here and all over the country that unless we achieve energy security, we will not really be independent. I would not like to add anything more than this at the moment. And I think this has been a very enlightening talk. Sir Kapurkar sir is a specialist in strategy. So once while I was traveling, I think his book was just released. I was very fortunate to think, I think it must have been the first copy, Fire and Fury, Strategies for Transforming Nations. Wonderful book, sir. I just finished it in that 2 hours flight. And sir, your vision on strategies is always very inspiring for every one of us. I'm sure we as the DAE family and the INS here in Hyderabad will take all efforts to take your vision forward and ensure that we achieve energy security and your strategies for decarbonization. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, everybody. Jai.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sanjay sir, for that lecture, for that address. Now I'd like to request our director, Dr. D.K. Sinha, to present a memento to Sanjay Chaubey sir, CMD ECIL, in appreciation of his contribution and support to make this even more memorable. I would request Srajila to help director sir to hand over this memento to Sanjay sir. Thank you, sir. I now request Dr. Sir to hand over a memento. We have Sri N. Sai Baba with us as a special guest to this function. So I request D.K. Sinha Saab to hand over this memento to him.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. At this moment, we would like to virtually present a memento to Dr. Dinesh Srivastava for being the guiding light in all the activities of Hyderabad chapter during his tenure as a chairman and later. So let us do the honors. Thank you. Now, let me invite Dr. T.S. Sunil Kumar, Additional Director, R&D, and Secretary, INS Hyderabad Chapter, to propose the vote of thanks. Sir, please.
Namaskar. Ladies and gentlemen, we had a memorable event today. The webinar series on the occasion of the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav has been inaugurated by our revered Chairman AEC and Secretary DAE, Dr. K.N. Vyas. And this series has been mentioned by our speakers and Director AMD also. It forms part of the activities organized by India to showcase the vision of India's future in terms of reforms, development and technology towards achieving the Atmanirbharata, one of the topic which very close to our Kakodkar sir also, which he has spoken. And we had a good Shubharam today, and we were fortunate to have Sri K.N. Vyas sir, Chairman AEC, with us despite his pressing requirements in other activities. Sir, we are very grateful to you for sparing the time to join us today. We all know that our speaker today was, the inaugural speaker was an illustrious nuclear technologist and a visionary, Dr. Padma Vibhushan, Dr. Anil Kakodkar, who has made signature developments in the field of energy, education and societal development. The concept of silage, which is very close to his heart, he is working on that aspect nowadays. Let me express our indebtedness, the whole AMD family and the INS Hyderabad chapter's indebtedness and gratitude to Kakodkar sir, who has enlightened us with his vision on the energy security and also using the nuclear technology to achieve clean energy utilization. The activities of INS Hyderabad chapter has been guided by three unit chiefs here, particularly Dr. Dinesh Srivastava, CE NFC, and Rear Admiral Sanjay Chaubey, retired, who is the CMD ECIL. They have been constructively encouraging all the programs and all the programs which is organized by the Indian Nuclear Society Hyderabad chapter. We are grateful to Dr. Dinesh Srivastava and Chaubey sir for accepting our invitation. Dinesh Srivastava sir was to be physically present here, but due to his urgent requirements at NFC, he has joined us virtually, and as Chaubey sir is with us, we are grateful to them. This being a webinar series, many unit chiefs of DAE and our seniors and other nuclear scientists have joined. As of now, we have got around 190 participants, which include Dr. Shashank Chaturvedi, Dr. R.A. Badwe, Sri P.S. Parihar, former director AMD, Sri Dr. G.K. Day, and additional directors of AMD like R. Mohanty, A.K. Bhatt, A.K. Chaturvedi, and others. And so also so many other names are there, which I don't have the list right now with me. And Dr. Sai Baba, Raja Ramana Fellow, and former CE NFC is physically present here. So also Dr. T. Srinivas, head Bindi of BRC, also is here, along with my colleagues in the regions, the regional directors, the officers in the different parts of the field areas, and the heads of groups who are all present here. We are all grateful for your patient attendance to this program and making this a good success. Organizing this seminar is a teamwork. I sincerely acknowledge the guidance given by the Dr. D.K. Sinha, the chairman of Indian Nuclear Society Hyderabad chapter and director AMT, for his guidance. co-additional directors B. Saravanan and R. Mamalan for their sharing the responsibilities, and the team of efficient team of officers who have seen that the work, the program is successful, particularly from PMSG, Instrumentation, Engineering Services Group, to name a few, Sri Dr. Krishna Kumar, who was the comparer, Sri Nagabhushanam, Rajesh Singh, Dheeraj Pandey, our CANDO, Anjali Kumar. We are all, and M. Srinivas, of course, we are thankful to them. And this series will be continuing. Our next program under this webinar series will be on September 17, 2021. A noted space scientist, Dr. M.Y.S. Prasad, will be the speaker on that day. We will be communicating the details shortly, and on behalf of the INS Hyderabad chapter and the AMD, we invite all of you to join that program also. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. To conclude the function, we have the national anthem. So let us all stand together. Thank you all, and we have arranged a cup of tea in the adjacent foyer to this hall. So please join us for that. Thank you. Thank you.